Good morning. This is Rose Minton from Heights Consulting, and I'm the moderator today of this webinar on personnel performance measures. And it's a very hot topic for the 311 Synergy Group. A lot of interest, as we have 45 participants registered for this webinar. The 311 Synergy Group is an industry networking group. We do information sharing versus discussion in these webinars. And we also meet yearly, with our next meeting being in Tampa, Florida, beginning on April the 28th. So we look forward to you all budgeting and joining us there in Tampa for 2.5 days of fun-filled and educational networking opportunities. Our next webinar is on September 26th, and we'll be introducing the topic and some new panelists at that time. So we'd like for you to join us on September the 26th for the webinar. And also, we'd like you to join us on LinkedIn. That's where we manage our membership. If you go to LinkedIn and you put in the 311 Synergy Group, if you're not already a member, please join. We'll do the approval, and then you'll participate in all the communication and discussions that we do. I'd like to introduce our panelists today. Esther Tenenbaum from the City of Albuquerque. She's taken the lead in putting together these webinars for this year, monthly interactive webinars with hot topics. So thank you, Esther, for doing that. We welcome Lois Bruce from the City of Columbus, Cheryl Johnson from the City of Philadelphia, Karen Larson from the City of Provo, Lana Wood, she's from the City of Sacramento, although the rolling slides had her in some other city. We'll guarantee that Lana is in the City of Sacramento. And I'm Rose Minton from Heights Consulting, moderating this webinar today. If you do have questions as the panelists are talking, if you will look on the right-hand side, the lower right-hand side of your screen, there is the opportunity for you to submit a question, and we'll moderate questions and answers at the end of the open discussion by our panelists. And we'll also be posting these slides that have been prepared ahead of time. Those will be posted at the LinkedIn site under 311 Synergy Group, and also at our site at CS Week. We'd like to thank CS Week for supporting us with these webinars and many, many other much other support that they give us, including providing space and support for our meetings. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Esther, and Esther will take us through some prepared information and begin to facilitate this roundtable discussion.
Thank you very much, Rose. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Before we get into the actual discussion, let me just say hello again in case I got cut off. Welcome to our discussion. I just want to let you know this is one of those things we hope you'll join us in. These are just discussions, no preparation necessary. If you'd like to be a panelist on any of our topics, we'd love for you to join us. Also, if there are any hot topics that you would like to see discussed in a roundtable informal discussion, please just let us know. We'd love to have that information. This is an awesome group to be able to share what's going on, what you do well, what you need help with. And so thank you to our panelists today for joining us. Today we're going to be discussing personnel and performance measures. These are two critical components of a call center. And without appropriate guidelines, procedures, or measurements and follow-through, we all know we cannot be successful. As you'll see today with our participants sharing and addressing certain questions or practices they have, that there's not one magic formula. There are so many ways and different ways to do these things in order to achieve success in our call centers. So I'm going to go through some of the prepared questions that we have and go through the group. So I'm going to start with Cheryl Johnson from the City of Philadelphia. So good morning, Cheryl.
Good morning.
So I was wondering if you wouldn't mind addressing the items on slide number 5 for us from Philadelphia's perspective.
Sure. We do have a union environment, and there are about 45 agents that we have. Our hours of operation are Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. We do have extended hours for special events and emergencies. In terms of disciplinary actions, because we are a union environment, it is a progressive step process. So we start out with verbals, writtens, and then we move into a series of hearings that progress up through termination.
Great.
Attendance issues, again, our attendance issues and performance issues are handled in the same way under the disciplinary action process, and that's, again, driven by the fact that we are a union environment. And in terms of do we have growth opportunity at our call center, we do, not so much from a promotional standpoint because we are limited there due to the budget, but we do provide opportunities via projects and opportunities for people to grow and expand their knowledge, and we do that via a mentorship program.
Great. So I just have a couple of follow-up questions for you, Cheryl, on the information that you provided. Are all of your employees union or just your agents?
The agents and the supervisors are union. The rest of the staff is exempt.
Okay. And as far as the growth opportunities, do you have multiple levels of agents based on experience, or is it just one agent level and then they can grow with career opportunities more from a developmental?
So we have two levels of agents. We have the trainee, and then we have the agent position. We are in process of implementing a specialist, if you will, a lead type of position, and then the supervisor.
So as far as those growth opportunities, somebody joins your organization as a trainee, and do they automatically then go to another level, or do they have to qualify?
They actually have to qualify, so these are civil service positions. We have the opportunity to actually do internal departmental promotions only, so it's not open across the entire city. And then there's a set of criteria that they must meet in order to qualify for the next level.
Okay, great. So one more follow-up on that one. I know in Albuquerque, we have X number of positions at a higher level and X number of positions like at the trainee level. So we can only move people to the next level if those positions become available. Is that the same situation?
Yes, absolutely. It's all tied to the budget. And we look at, like, for instance, currently we have 3 agent positions available. So even though we may have 10 people who may apply, we will only fill those 3 positions.
Okay, great. And then one question about your disciplinary action. So what type of situations warrant disciplinary action in your organization?
Okay, so there are a variety of performance measures. So if you're not meeting those over a period of time, those things will qualify. Also, on the performance side, if you have 2 consecutive years of unsatisfactory performance, that is also a qualifier for escalated disciplinary action. Attendance, any gross misconduct issues as well would qualify.
And what is acceptable number of attendance incidents, and do you divide attendance and punctuality separately, or are they one category?
At the City of Philadelphia, they're treated separately.
Okay, so what is I, an employee, is acceptable for me for an attendance before I get into a disciplinary action?
Okay, so for us, it's a little bit complicated to actually assign a number. So we actually have to look at patterns of behavior because the employees have certain qualifying things that would not move them into disciplinary action. So as an example, if an employee calls out sick, and they come in with the medical certification, then we cannot move them into disciplinary action. That's part of the bargaining agreement with the union and under the civil service regs. So we are a challenge sometimes in that because of those two factors.
Right. And as far as what you consider a tardy, what is a tardy? Is it 1 minute late, 10 minutes late, half hour late?
For us, it's 1 minute. Our expectation is that at the start of your shift, you need to be in ready status, available to assist our customers. And we communicate this information actually during our orientation and onboarding process so people know very clearly at the very beginning what's expected.
Great. Thank you, Cheryl.
You're welcome.
Karen, I'm going to move to you. Karen's with the City of Provo. If you don't mind addressing these for our audience.
Sure. I will also say that and introduce a couple other staff members that I have with me that may have some input here. One is my floor manager and lead is Sherry Baum. And then I've also got Amanda Erkenbrack, who is our floor trainer and monitors all the scheduling and specific trainings for each individual.
Well, great. Welcome, Amanda and Sherry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We are not a union, thank goodness, sounds like. So we have a little bit more flexibility with some of our policies. We have 8 full-time employees, 5 part-time customer service reps, and 4 billing specialists. We also have, in our area as well, we have accumulated, or I said acquired, the business licensing technician as well under our operation. We are Monday through Friday, 7 to 6 operation. After hours, after the 6 p.m. Hour, all calls get transferred into our dispatch center that is managed by our energy department. And they do dispatch out some of our after hours service requests. Disciplinary actions, we do have a formal disciplinary policy that we must follow, and which includes the beginning of oral reprimands, written suspension, demotional, you know, and then dismissals. We also have the attendance issues, basically tardies and whatnot, and we can deny any request, even a sick leave request, if necessary. We do set goals and objectives for their attendance. We also will remove them from incentive programs if necessary. And, of course, then we go into all the disciplinary actions if, you know, the tardies or attendance issues are become a deal for them. On our performance issues are always brought to the customer service attention through call reviews, evaluations. We provide training and coaching to correct the behavior, and if still the performance issues exist, then we follow up with our discipline course of action that is in the city policy. We do have growth opportunities in our call center. We have just been revising our what we call our Career Series Advancement Program. Over a year ago, we had a career series advancement starting at a customer service rep 1, and it went 2, 3, and to a senior level. We did cap the senior level to be 3 seniors. We did not, due to, you know, it's like we don't need a lot of chiefs, so we needed to, you know, control that a little bit. We are revising that right now to be a 2-step only. Other than our billing specialist, you can move into a billing specialist technician, but just in our career series advancements, we have a customer service rep and then a senior customer service rep in that career.
So what made you find that program then?
Well, what was hard is because it had been in existence for many, many years, it was hard to do a market study on those positions. We are, of course, municipal with we manage all the billing and utility customer service, not only for the city 311. So when the HR department is trying to do a comparison of our customer service reps, it was apparently pretty difficult to do a matching market study and became very complicated. And so therefore, they recommended tearing this down to two levels. And because the first level was so far out of the market study, it was such an underpaid position, they decided to just combine them into 2.
So as far as the opportunity, so again, is there a qualifier, do I just automatically go to a different level after a certain time in position?
No, it's time of being in the position as well as testing, and evaluation of past performance. And so they have to first meet the requirement of being in a position for 3 years. And go ahead.
Once I've been in the position, Karen, for 3 years, then I can ask to take this test, and if I pass it, then I automatically get that role?
Yeah, and not necessarily even ask. We're proactive in monitoring the levels and when they're really due, because we do annual evaluations on the employees, and so at the evaluations, that typically will get discussed on their next step, where they go and what they need to qualify for.
Great. And I want to go back to the attendance again and performance issues. So as far as attendance, do you measure attendance and tardies separately? If so, can you give me what the parameters are that you use to measure that with?
You know, it also is a pattern for an employee, because they all have different patterns oftentimes and reasons for their issues. But we do have a policy of our tardies being, if they don't call in within 15 minutes, they go through the discipline. It begins the discipline process immediately, basically the verbals and to the writtens and to the, more formal and more harsh discipline process. We also measure the same thing on tardies, absences. We don't have a clear cut on how many absences they can have. It's just based on a pattern of their attendance, their performance, a combination. So
we do have that if they're absent from their position for two consecutive days, on the third day they must supply us some kind of physical release from their physician to come back into the position. If we don't have that.
And is that a city policy or is that your division's policy?
That is a city policy. So that
okay.
is citywide. And if they don't have that, that begins our disciplinary action immediately with that position.
Okay, great. And can you repeat for me how many total employees you have?
We have 8 full-time, 5 part-time, and 4 full-time billing. So we've got 8 customer service agents on the phones.
Great.
Okay.
Plus the 5 part-time. And the part-time are typically working 30 hours. They're almost full-time, really.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that, Karen and team. Let's move on to Lana with the City of Sacramento.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We are a union here at the City of Sacramento, and recently it's changed, so all employees within our call center are now union. Management used to be exempt, but they recently have been included into a union. We currently have 18 call takers, and we are getting to add 2 more positions, so shortly, once we get them trained, we'll have a total of 20. We are open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, including holidays. And we do have a disciplinary action in place. We start, being a union, as with Cheryl, we start with verbal, and then we have a documented counseling, which is the written. And the types of things that might trigger that disciplinary action, poor customer service, if we did not document something correctly or dispatch something out correctly that was a liability to the city, that is immediately a documented counseling. And, then of course there are the other things that might come along that aren't quite as cut and dried, performance measures. We've talked to you about this quite a few times and you haven't came up to our standards yet. We also do have an attendance policy in place. We are housed in the Department of General Services within the City of Sacramento, and the division itself, their policy is that a person must have 40 hours of sick leave time on the books. If they dip under that, we can put them on a medical certification request. Then we send them an official letter, and then any time they call in sick or leave sick for the day, they must bring us a doctor's note to substantiate that they were actually ill that day. And if we do have an employee, well, I kind of just covered what we do with attendance issues. With performance issues, you know, that is something, it's going to depend on the performance issues. I like, instead of just immediately saying you did something wrong, I like to find out what they were thinking and, of course, offer them any additional training that they might need, because a lot of times I don't think it's a willful misconduct. It's they were not, they forgot something or they weren't properly trained. So we try to incorporate that. We do have growth opportunity in our call center. We have customer service assistants, and then we have customer service representatives. And they do not have to test to move from a customer service assistant to a customer service representative, but they do have to have really good performance reviews and show that they are trying to do everything correct, that they have good attendance, that their tardies are minimal, and that they have a minimal error ratio, as well as standing up to what performance standards we have set. And of course, as Cheryl had talked about, budgets are indeed kind of tight these days. So once we have a little bit more play in our budget, we are fairly thin at the top. So there is an admin analyst and myself, and then an acting division manager. So we would love to have some opportunity for growth in those areas as well.
Thank you. And Lana, I just have another question for you about your attendance. So again, going back to the tardies, what do you consider a tardy? 1 minute, 10 minutes, half hour?
1 minute is considered a tardy.
Okay.
And I do track those weekly.
Okay. Great. And great. I appreciate it, Lana. Thank you so much. We'll
Thank
move
you.
To Lois. Lois
Hello.
Is joining us with the City of Columbus. Good morning, Lois.
Good morning. Okay, we are union, and total, including me, we have 22 people. Our hours are 7 a.m. to 6 p.m., Monday through Friday. Types of disciplinary action, similar to what we've heard before, we've got the progressive, oral, written, and then you can get suspension, et cetera. Attendance issues, we track tardies. You cannot have more than 3 in a 30-day, in a rolling 30-day period. And like Lana, even 1 minute over is considered a tardy. So we just monitor it closely. You know who your attendance problems are and who they aren't. So you keep a close eye on tardies. Also, we keep track of documented and undocumented sick instances. So similar to what Lana was saying, if you get up to 5 undocumented sick instances in a calendar year, then we put you on sick leave notification, meaning any and all instances of sick leave going forward until the end of the year, you have to provide a doctor's note. And if you don't, you're automatically considered AWOL, which is grounds for discipline. So once people get up to about 3 or 4, you know, they know that they really, really need to watch it. So that is in place to at least force people, if they call in sick, to go to the doctor, or if they leave or come in late, you know, to go to the doctor. Other performance issues would be call quality in general, poor availability percentage. That's something that is tracked and measured monthly, as well as their call quality. Attendance, of course, is you know, one of the bigger issues, just because our agents are given 96 hours of sick pay at the beginning of every year. So that's a lot, and they have the option to either use it or roll it over or take sick leave reciprocity in January of the following year, but many choose to just go ahead and use those 96 hours, so that's a lot. It's very generous. growth opportunity, I would love to say that there is, but currently there really isn't. I've got three lead reps that kind of act as supervisors or training assistants, and they've all been with the city 25 plus years. So until they retire or move to a different position, which isn't likely, you know, I won't have those positions open. And I am also budgeted for a management analyst that would do staffing and scheduling, but finance has not approved that yet. So hopefully when that gets approved, then there would be a growth opportunity with that position.
Great. Yeah, I think you point out a very good point is that sometimes that growth opportunity just isn't there based on a call center only having so many levels. So I think earlier on, Cheryl or Karen or both may have mentioned that you need to work with developing the people too and giving them additional skill sets, because in your case, Lois, where you mentioned that unless they leave, which isn't likely, there isn't upward mobility, and that can be that can affect morale and performance.
Definitely.
So
mm-hmm.
a very good point. Okay, well, I have a panelist question. Participant question for the panelists before we move on to the next set of slides, and that is, this is from Jody Helmer. She wants to know what the population of your city is. So I'm going to start with Cheryl. What population is your city that you serve?
Okay, so we have about 1.5 million.
Okay, great. Thank you. Karen?
Much smaller than that, 130,000.
Wow, okay. Lana?
We're at right about 500,000.
Great. And Lois?
About 800,000, 850,000.
Great. All right, we're going to move on to the next slide. Before I do that, is there anyone on the panel that wants to share any other practices that we maybe didn't address in the personnel side of the business?
This is Cheryl at the City of Philadelphia. So while we talked a lot about the disciplinary process, we do spend a lot of time in terms of the training and also the coaching side, because we find that, you know, if we're very proactive on that end, that will catch the majority of the problems, and
that's
we don't have a huge number of progressive discipline issues that we're dealing with.
That's a very good point. My other observation in listening to all the panelists was how many other cities actually look for medical documentation, whether it be a doctor's note or certification that they were out. So I'm just curious, I have a little bit of an HR background. Do you feel that that has helped reduce the number of attendance issues? Because I know that it's pretty easy for individuals to go to their doctor and get a note from the doctor. So I'm just going to ask that real quick, Cheryl, your thoughts?
For us, it's kind of a mixed bag, because with the union environment, they also provide the benefits, and apparently there's sort of a warehouse clinic that employees can go to get a note even without a medical professional ever looking at them. However,
okay.
Similar to what I heard some of the other panelists say, they do have to provide certification, and if they don't, then we're able to take some additional actions. And then we're able to consult with HR as well if we have any concerns about abuses, and may be able to move forward with discipline if appropriate.
Great. Thank you, Cheryl. Karen?
With that three-day limit, we usually, I've only had one occurrence where I've had an employee push even the second day. Typically, if they're out one day, they're back within the next morning afternoon. We do encourage them when they call in that if they're beginning to feel well, our policy does say that they must report to work.
We can ask for that. This is Karen. That was Sherry. I'm sorry. We can ask for those sick leave notes at any time. One day, it doesn't matter. Policy really is pretty open for that. So if in their past they've even had a history of this calling in, we can request it on the day. If they called in on a day, we can just simply ask for a doctor's note. And we don't feel like there's been any abuse of that, and it seems to help.
It does. It keeps it
great.
In control.
Nice. That's great. Thank you. Lana?
Yes, I have found that it makes a huge difference in our attendance.
Great. Okay, and Lois?
It makes a difference after they get up to about 4 or 5, knowing that, you know, if I call off sick today, I'm going to have to go to, you know, the minute clinic at least, or the doctor to have some kind of documentation. I think it helps once they get to that point, but I can have people get to 4 and 5 by February or March, you know, of the year.
Right.
Very early on in the year once they get kind of a clean slate. So I would prefer to see it a rolling 12-month period as opposed to calendar year, but similar to what, you know, Karen and Cheryl and Lana had said.
Okay, great. Well, I know we have another question from Audrey. And, Audrey, I'm going to wait till we go through the next set of slides to see if we address your question. If not, we'll come back to it. We'll definitely answer it. So, panelists, we're going to move on to the next categories of questions, and that is call center measurements. So the hard part is we can be really consistent and do disciplinary action, but what methods do we use to measure? Because everybody's got something different. So that's what these are kind of talking about. What are the measurements and how do you do that? So, Cheryl, I'm going to start with you. If you could go through this slide with us and kind of give us a little bit of background from your city's perspective.
Sure. So in terms of attendance and tardiness, you know, as I mentioned before, we look at patterns of behavior, but we do have some measures in place where, you know, after 5 undocumented absences that an employee may be placed on a sick abuse list, and they'll get a warning to let them know that that's coming. On a monthly basis, the supervisors sit down with each of their team members, and part of that review, they will discuss any attendance or tardiness issues because, again, we try to focus on being proactive in that respect. And that would also include if they volunteer to work overtime and they call out just for the overtime portion, we have the option to discipline them for that. And then okay. I have the benefit of having a workforce analyst who actually monitors our attendance and tardiness in conjunction with the HR time and attendance system.
Great. And so this workforce person, they're not a supervisor or call handler?
No, they're not.
Okay.
And it's an exempt position in our organization.
Great.
And in reference to the
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Okay. In reference to performance measurements, so we have some key measurements that the employees are managed to, and they receive stats on a weekly basis, and then again on a monthly basis they have one-on-one meetings with their supervisors, and these are drill downs as part of our overall departmental measures. So their key goals are their percentage of time and ready status, the percentage of calls logged, the percentage of service requests logged, their service request accuracy, a quality monitoring score, as well as a customer satisfaction score. There's some other metrics that are not key metrics that the supervisor will discuss because they typically impact one or more of those key metric areas. In addition to that, the employees have the ability to go in the system and look at things like they can see themselves how many tickets that they are doing every day. They can talk with their supervisor if they want to see some stats on a daily basis as well. In addition, we have something called Philly Stat, which is actually a divisional performance measurement that we have to attend quarterly. So we post and educate the entire staff about how we're doing as a department because it is an aggregate of all of their performance as well. And we will post this up on a bulletin board as well. And we also issue a daily scorecard with the departmental performance as well that is sent out via email and also posted up on the bulletin board to help the employees to see how their individual performance feeds up into our overall success.
Great.
Was there a question?
No, go ahead.
Okay. So we do, as I mentioned, performance reviews. There are monthly meetings that are one-on-one. There are annual performance reviews as well. There are also daily huddles that are had at a team level, and they get a template, again, that shows their individual scorecard, if you will, that will tell them how they're doing in those particular areas, and a discussion on how, you know, what the issues may be and how they are performed. And the employee is very involved in that because we don't assume that we know what the issues are. The supervisor can give some observations on some things, but also they're encouraged to have a dialogue with the employee because sometimes the employee will come out and say, well, I'm not really sure how to handle, you know, this particular thing, and I struggle with this, and the supervisor can determine whether it's a training issue and or performance issue and take the appropriate action.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Karen.
I'm going to defer to my trainer here. She has all the particulars and details of our training and monitoring of that. Amanda.
Hi, this is Amanda. In reference to attendance and tardies, we use our timekeeping system to monitor.
You use your what?
Our timekeeping system, the method
okay.
in and out. We don't necessarily have set limits on how many times they can be absent or tardy. But if we notice patterns or as needed, we'll set specific and individual goals, such as if you have 3 tardies this quarter, then we'll move into disciplinary action. As far as performance measurements, what we expect out of our employees is 90% call review. We have very, very high standards as far as the call review is in terms of quality. And then when we look at their call reviews on an annual basis, we want to see less than a 5% variance in their scores. So we'd like consistency in the quality. We really push for that. And then otherwise, we also have a workplace citizenship program that encourages them to make positive contributions, whether it's in terms of recommendations, things we can improve on, that sort of thing. And that's wrapped into their overall evaluation, which then is done by Sherry, the manager, and she would also follow through with any disciplinary action as needed. On the work reviews, what we do is we do 3 call reviews per agent per month. We coach them and train them in specific areas that they're struggling in or specific things that they need extra help with. And then we measure their performance in terms of improvement from where they were last time to where they've gone now. And then we'll set new goals and reevaluate it next month. Did you want information on our average talk times? And
if you have that with you, that would be great.
So our average talk time is about 3 minutes and 40 seconds. It's a little bit higher, I would assume, than some, but I think that's in part because we deal with utilities. Our average handle time, we encourage our agents to finish up all of their work while they're on the phone call. It doesn't always happen, and it can't always happen, but that's our goal, that they finish up everything while they're on the phone call in order to reduce that after call and unavailable time. We just barely got a new call monitoring system, and we're not quite sure how to accurately report on the unavailable and after call. We have a pretty good idea that it's fairly low, but we need more specifics on that. And then our transfer percentage is something we really try to encourage them not to transfer unless it's absolutely necessary. Right now we're averaging 53 transfers per agent per month. So it's fairly low as opposed to where we were about a year ago.
Great. Thank you so much from the City of Provo. Lena.
Hi. So I pretty much already touched on how we measure attendance and then, once again, our tardiness. Our performance measures at this time, we want each of our call takers to take at least 100 calls per day. And, of course, they should have at least 100 tickets as well, and oftentimes there's more than that because we handle a variety of departments. So you get one person on the phone and they want to report something for code enforcement and something for potholes and then some streetlights. So we make sure that their tickets have exceeded their call count.
Okay.
And we do work review, and to be honest, I, with an admin analyst and myself, we probably don't get to people as often as we should. And we do have performance discussions with our employees. However, with the staffing that we have, unfortunately, we kind of hit the high people and let them know a great job, and then we hit the low people and see what we need to do in order to assist them in getting up to the 100 call count per day that we require on our employees that work during peak hours. We send out stats to them every month, and it's sent out as a whole, so everyone in the call center gets to see where everyone else is. And then the other thing that we add on that is we add what percentage of our call center calls did you take.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So that's kind of nice when you can look at that and say, wow, I took 8.9%. You know,
right.
you feel good about that. Our average talk time is currently 2.5 minutes, and we also encourage our employees to work through the flow of their call and make sure that everything is entered while they're on the call with the customer. I do not have an average for after-call work or being unavailable. I do know that anything over about 2.5 to 3 minutes catches my attention, and I'm always IMing them, instant messaging them on our phone system that we have. You know, are you okay? Do you need assistance? So I do monitor it that way. And then we have a very low transfer percentage, and I would like to say that that's because our call takers are all wonderful, which they are, but I think there's only about 3 places in the city at this point that we have that have call agents that we could transfer them to. So we are kind of forced to adhere to a very low transfer percentage.
Great. Thank you. All right. Next, we're on to Lois.
Okay. We pretty much already talked about attendance and tardiness. Performance measures, call quality, they get 3 to 4 calls a month scored, and then feedback is given, and just looking for coaching opportunities and making sure that they've, you know, utilized that, A, they've created the service request correctly, they've utilized their soft skills and empathy if needed, and they also get scored on making sure that they give the caller their confirmation number at the end of the call. That way the caller knows that their information has been entered, and they have to advise the caller of the website and where they can go and check the service request for status updates. So call quality is a big one. Agent availability is tracked also. That obviously measures their available, non-available percentage and time. And I also look at away from desk time with a customer time. Since they are giving out the confirmation number, the service request number on every call, they should not need a whole lot of with a customer time. Occasionally they'll get a call that requires additional research, but in most cases they don't have to, you know, there's nothing that they need to do after the call. So availability, and then wrap-up code. Wrap-up code is the code that they enter into the IVR system that explains the reason for the call for everything except a service request. We get about 40% of all of our calls are just general information. So in order for me to get a better idea of what those calls are about, they enter the wrap-up code. And the only way to really measure that is wrap-up code variance to the team average, because there really aren't goals per se. But if somebody is, I can look at the outliers, and if somebody has, say, for instance, a transfer percentage, or refer to, you know, non-city government, and their number and their percentage of overall wrap-up codes is a lot higher than the rest of the team, then I know that they may be utilizing that code more often than they should. It just gives me a better idea of, you know, what kind of code they're using and what the calls are about. So they're accountable for all of those things. They get like a monthly update on availability and call quality. If I try to take as much time as I can and listen to each call individually with them, but time does not always allow it. So I think somebody was talking about kind of the middle of the road people that I'm guilty of that, that, you know, if the calls were good and adequate, unless they ask to listen to the call, I really won't take the time and play the call with them, and I probably should do more of that, even if the calls are really good, just to give them a lot of positive feedback. But so they get some kind of update every month, and then they get a yearly evaluation, and they're measured on call quality, attendance, availability percentage. Our average talk time is 2 minutes 20 seconds. Average handle time, I'm sorry, go ahead. Did you have a question? No. Average handle time is about 2 minutes 45 seconds. So there's a system-generated wrap-up time that they get automatically that's 30 seconds, and most use about 20 seconds of that. The after-call work is what I just talked about, the system-generated wrap-up time. Unavailable is tracked in their availability percentage, and the goal for that is 90%. And schedule adherence, just making sure that they adhere. They may not go to break right at 2:15, you know, because of a long call. It may be 2:17, 2:18. They're not penalized for that, but I do make sure that, you know, they've got 15-minute breaks and not 18-minute breaks, and 60-minute lunches and not an hour and 4-minute lunches. So that is tracked very closely. And transfer percentage is tracked within the wrap-up code report.
Great. Thank you, Lois. So I just want to throw this out to our panelists, too, is that, you know, I know we're always looking for better ways to do things technology-wise, is what are some of the systems that you use to measure? How are you measuring your attendance? Is it manual, or do you use your phone logons? What is it you use? The same thing for where are you getting your reporting? Do you have a tool that measures your average handle time and spits out reports, or is that coming directly from your phone? So I know we're getting low on time, so I'm going to run really quickly through the panel and just see if there's some systems out there that maybe some of us might not be aware of. Cheryl?
Okay, so for us, in terms of the attendance and stuff, we actually use reporting is manual, but we actually have a time and attendance for the agents and supervisors, so we're able to do some reporting through that. For the other systems, we're using manual systems or pulling it directly from the telephone. We do use a system called CCMIS that gives us a lot of our call reporting data.
Okay, great. Thank you. Karen?
We, for our attendance, we have our timekeeping system, which is called HBS. So we use that to gather all of our data for our tardies and our absences. We also have a software, the software for our phone call stats. We have a call copy is the name of the product, and it is for the call recording, and that's how we measure the monitoring and the review of the calls. We also have Task, which is our software that gives us the majority of our phone reporting and our average talk times, et cetera.
Great. Thank you very much, Karen. Lana?
The attendance is pulled manually. They do enter their attendance into what we call ECAPS, which is the payroll, and you could pull reports from there. But I keep a running log on my desktop, so I have it easy at my fingertips. And then our average handle time and average talk time is pulled from IPCC, and that is our phone system.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you. Lois?
Attendance is pulled manually from our Genesis, which is the payroll system, and I pull that every few days just to look at tardies, and we have a policy that if they have medical documentation, they have to send it to HR and not give it to me. So I may enter somebody's time in as sick, but then HR will go in and change it to documented sick. So that's constantly updating, so I'm pulling all of that, but all of that is manual. AHT availability, wrap-up codes, all the statistical information comes from our IBR system, and every single call is recorded, and that is called Interactive Intelligence Telephone System. And I don't know what the cost was, sorry.
That's okay.
Okay.
All right, great. I do believe we may have addressed Audrey's question. So, Audrey, if we didn't, can you just please send us some additional follow-up questions you'd like? And then we just received a question from Margaret. She says, you all say you have talked about attendance measures. Specifically, how many occurrences, tardies and absence, does an employee accrue? I just lost my screen. Does an employee accrue before you start the disciplinary action process? I know we touched on that a little bit, but I want to go back through the panelists to see if we can address that question a little bit more specifically for Margaret. Cheryl, can you address that question from your point of view?
Okay, so in the city of Philadelphia, we in 301, we don't have a hard and fast number. What we look at is patterns of behavior because, again, we're bound by the civil service regs and the union, so we'll look for patterns of absence. And we do have something called AWOL, absence without pay, where if they don't call in by a certain time, we can do that, or if we send them home, that type of thing. So we look at patterns versus a hard and fast number.
Great, thank you. Karen?
We typically, at three absences is when our concern rises at that point and disciplinary starts to take place at that point.
So is that three separate absences or 3 days in one, like, you know how there's incidents versus number of days?
It's typically three consecutive is where we've been.
But if I call in once a month for 3 months in a row?
Yes.
Okay.
If you had a set pattern where you were calling consistently, if it were a Tuesday after a holiday and it was consistently, or a Monday, then I would sit down with the employee, ask if we had some problems, if we needed to schedule a vacation day, a leave day for them for that day, trying to get them out of that pattern that they have. It's very visible within our timekeeping system to see that pattern.
So it's more of a consistent basis on a pattern.
Great. Thank you, Karen. Lana?
Well, if our general services policy is that if you use more than 24 hours in a quarter, then that would send it over into disciplinary action. And for tardies, I don't really have a hard and fast rule. Typically, if you have more than three in a quarter, I'm certainly going to sit down and talk with you. But, you know, it's good. There is no hard and fast rule on when I actually take that to disciplinary measures.
Great. Thank you. Lois?
And this is all governed by the AFSCME, the union contract. For tardies, it's three or more in a rolling 30-day period. So I'm constantly looking at that. And then for attendance, really, I mean, someone could conceivably have, 96 or more sick instances, but as long as they're documented, I can't do anything about that. They've got that 96 hours to use how they want, but when they get up to five undocumented is when the discipline will start.
Great. You know, to Lois's point, and I think all of our organizations probably have this, where everybody earns sick leave, the mentality is, well, it's my benefit time, I should be able to use it, but in a call center, that isn't necessarily, we're not able to deal with that and be able to still deliver our services. So I know for us in Albuquerque, that's a big challenge. You may have earned that, but it isn't an entitlement to days off during the year. So we have some real stringent policies in Albuquerque because of the impact attendance has to our performance and our ability to serve the customers. So, yeah, Lois, I think we can all appreciate it, but 96 hours a year, boy, that's a lot. Yeah, it really is. We have a question from Rob, and Rob isn't sure whether we'll get all the way through this, but we'll certainly give it a good try. He wants to get an understanding of how you calculate your availability, what is in and what is out. So, Cheryl, if you don't track availability now, that's fine. Just let us know that, but we'll start with Cheryl.
Okay, we track availability, and for us, they have to be in available status for 80% of the time, and that's tracked via the login. So they actually, we use login codes, and so they have
to
be.
So you have the ability that if they go to a quality coaching session, they can press their phone code, and it lets you know they went to quality?
Right, but we have something called walkaway codes that would do that.
Do you have any cross-referencing to ensure that they're just not pressing a code?
Well, that's the responsibility of the supervisor to manage that. And one of the things, tools that they do use is a downtime sheet. And the managers, the supervisors will actually go and audit because they can go back in the system and they can look at things and actually verify that.
Great. Thank you. Karen.
I'm going to go ahead and handle this one. It's Amanda. We are more so concerned about the time that they're not available. We look at the time that they spend in our auxiliary mode or their after-call mode because there's usually a queue, and so there's not a lot of time that they're available without calls in that queue. But we do look at how often they're not in the queue ready to take a call.
Okay, great. Thank you. Lena.
We do not have a set percentage that we have established that they need to be ready. But I do monitor that every day throughout the day by looking at the codes that they're choosing on our phone system.
Great. Thank you. Lois.
With availability, there is a very detailed report that I get that I pull that shows every single phone state. So I'm measuring availability and unavailability, and for instance, any kind of training session or project assignment time, while they don't keep track of it on a downtime log, even computer maintenance, if they've had a computer problem, if that time was not pre-approved by me or one of the lead reps, or if they didn't let one of the lead reps know about it, then that time is not approved when I do the availability percentages. So I can drill down and see, you know, how long was Lois in away from desk on this particular day, or what is her average for the month. And that will definitely show you, you know, outside of the team average, where the problems may lay and address those issues as they come up.
Great. Well, thank you to all of our panelists. I just added some other slides of things that we do in Albuquerque, and you can take a look at them. Remember, you can get this information at LinkedIn. I do want to encourage those of you that did not get a chance to ask your questions to feel free to do so again at our site on LinkedIn. And we're always interested. We could probably go on for a couple more hours about measurements, I'm sure. But we're always interested in topics you'd like to have discussed. Our panelists, you were awesome. Great information to share. I'm going to turn it over to Rose to go ahead and close the session with.
Thank you, Esther. And what a good conversation that the panelists have had about performance measures. And we heard different things from different cities, and that's to be expected. But the key is to create the performance measures, to create the expectation assessment with your reps, and then follow up on that. And it's not always an easy thing to do, but it probably is more important, that feedback loop, than actually what the measure is. So thanks again to the participants. We will post this slide presentation on LinkedIn, and Esther will be putting together the webinar for next month, and we're excited to do this and have this kind of participation. So look for the announcement coming soon, and we'll see you all next month. And in addition, we'll see you in Tampa in April. This concludes the webinar. Thanks for participating.